Today we're having Laurent Chevalier, who will talk about intermittency. And I would like to point out to all that Laurent will be giving a series of lectures, a mini course, so to speak, starting in February, the details of which will be sent later on. And maybe Laurent will say something more about this. So Laurent, we lost you completely. Did he disappear?
Oh, he is still here, but he stopped sharing.
But I don't see him.
Yeah.
Do you guys see him? Oh. No.
He's still here.
Let me look down the list if he's still connected. He's not. He's not even connected. What happened?
There is one Laurent.
Pardon?
There is
one Laurent? Where? Oh, yeah, I see him. Hey, Laurent.
Wait, Jed, I have an issue.
You have
I'm
an issue?
Coming.
Okay, good. Yes, so thanks again for giving this talk and for agreeing to give the mini course in February. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Jalal, for the invitation. So yes, so you asked me to do an overview. So it's not a review, it's an overview. So I might miss a lot of names, I'm sorry. Last talk of Oliver Bueller, he was giving the reference of the book of Frisch, and I think that really it's an excellent book. So if you want a review on the intermittency phenomenon in fluid turbulence, please take a look at that beautiful book of Frisch. So today it's a physicist talking. So usually physicists, they start with showing experiment. And I think my favorite illustration of turbulence is the experiments that took place in the biggest wind tunnel that exists in France and probably in Europe, which is in Modane, close at the border with the Italy. So you can see my pointer. Yes. So that's 150 meters long. You can see the size of the core here. So it's a big wind tunnel. And as we will see, it's very important for the physics because you want to make sure that the large integral length scale is very big compared to the small dissipative length scale. So that's a wind tunnel. If there are no obstacles, the fluid here, air, goes straight, so there's no turbulence, it's laminar, etc. So you need to put an obstacle. And recent experiments, they were using a huge grid, which is on the right, and you can see the size of a guy here. And the grid, so the fluid, the air will crash onto that grid, will destabilize, and that will create turbulence. All right. And so the complete purpose of fluid turbulence is to study and understand the velocity profile. So here I'm representing velocity as a function of space and as a function of space over the length scale that I call capital L. And you can see a highly fluctuating velocity profile around the zero average value. So for the specialist, so here I'm completely hiding the Taylor hypothesis. That will be my starting point. I will be studying the spatial velocity profile, So the whole aim, how come you understand that you inject energy at the characteristic length scale capital L. So capital L typically is the size of one of the is a couple of is 20 centimeters, 25 centimeters. So how come you can understand that you inject energy at that large length scale, which is here, the typical correlation length scale of the velocity? How come you end up with a lot of fluctuations and a lot of small scales? That's the big thing to understand in turbulence. How do you generate these small scales? And as many people know, there will be a cascading process that will take the energy from the large scales and take them towards the small scales. That makes turbulence a very efficient way to dissipate energy. All right, so if you do that, you end up, so I start recalling the basic statistical property of turbulence, which is, traditionally speaking, we represent the power spectrum. So what is a power spectrum? You compute the velocity correlation, which is just the average of the product of velocity at position x up to position x plus L, and you take the Fourier transform over L. And you end up, so Wiener-Kitching theorem, E of k is a positive quantity. So that's an energy, it's a spectral energy, and you represent it as a logarithmic fashion, as a function of the logarithm of the wavelength. So what you can see is that at large scales, it means at very small wavelength, basically the spectrum is flat. It means that the velocity profile, if you zoom out the velocity profile, you have white noise. So the spectrum is flat. If you go at scales smaller than the integral length scale, capital L, you start building up a power law, which is known as the Kolmogorov energy spectrum. Because you are in a real situation, the viscosity is finite. At one point, it will become smooth. So the spectral energy will decrease very rapidly, which is kind of exponential cutoff. The full purpose of turbulence is to understand the buildup of that power law. All right. So please do not hesitate to ask questions. I have many things to show, but I will be happy to take questions. So, equivalent way to say things is to look at the variance of the velocity increment. So velocity increment is just the evolution of velocity over a certain length scale L. All right, so people usually call it, so the velocity increment is the simplest wavelet that you can build up, and Frisch and Vergasola used to call it the poor man's wavelet. But that's a wavelet, and you compute the second order moment of the velocity increment, and you represent it in a logarithmic fashion in this way. And that's the same phenomenology. At large scale, the variance of the velocity increment is independent on the scales. It means that basically at very large scale, the velocity profile is kind of a white noise. And when you enter in the inertial range, you have the development of a power law, which is given by a certain exponent 2/3, which is completely equivalent to the k minus 5/3 of the inertial range seen in the spectral space. So I guess many people know that. And it's universal. Huh? You can do measurements anywhere on the globe, even using a very small wind tunnel, and you will get that same behavior. And obviously, when you are going below the Kolmogorov length scale, at very small length scales, there the viscosity is taking place and is damping energy, is transforming the energy into heat. And that's scales smaller than the Kolmogorov-Lang scale, the velocity profile is smooth, and so the velocity increment is proportional to L because of the Taylor development, and so the square is proportional to L square. That's why you have a trivial power law here. Okay. So that was well understood for a long time. So here I'm presenting an equation that everybody knows, the Navier-Stokes equations, that I will certainly not use today. The precision that I will like to give is that in that situation, in that physical situation, I'm describing a statistically stationary state of turbulence. So if you want to reach that state, you have to add to the Navier-Stokes equation a forcing. And there is something crazy that is happening. You keep forcing the flow with constant energy, and the fluid doesn't blow up. The variance remains finite. That's fantastic. The heat equation doesn't do that, but Navier-Stokes does. And one of the biggest conjecture in math for Navier-Stokes, I guess, is the independence of the velocity variance as the viscosity on the viscosity. So to engineers would tell you it's normal, it's inertia. But if you want to understand it from the microscopic point of view given by the Navier-Stokes equations, that's far from being trivial. And actually, so Kolmogorov, he has that beautiful sentence. So Kolmogorov, he was doing theorem when he was 12 years old on Fourier series, but very quickly he realized that the problem was too difficult from the Navier-Stokes equations. And one solution, so first he said, we have to use random fields. That would be the end of my lecture. And meanwhile, because the mathematical framework was not developed yet, we have to process experimental data. So that sentence coming from one of the biggest mathematicians of the last century is fantastic. No questions? I go ahead. All right, if you want to understand that, so everybody knows that, you have to look for the kinetic energy budget, which is very simple to get. Even me, I can do it from the Navier-Stokes. You compute the variation of the amplitude square of the velocity. So up to a spatial flux given here with I, a certain vector that has a certain value anyway, it is governed by the action of viscosity, and the injection of energy. So as I was saying, you keep feeding the flow with energy, but you reach a statistically stationary state. So if you take an average on the left and right hand side, what you do, it's so because it's statistically stationary, the expectation of the derivative is zero. Because it will be statistically homogeneous, there is no preferential orientation, it's isotropic. The expectation of the flux of the spatial vector is zero. So you end up with that very weird equality, which is a quantity on the left that I call epsilon that obviously depends on the viscosity, is equal to something which is independent on the viscosity. And basically it says, so we are reaching the one of the first axioms of Kolmogorov that says that at infinite Reynolds number, meaning in the limit of vanishing viscosity, the dissipation is independent of the viscosity and reach a finite positive value, which is completely fixed by the large scale flow it's equal to a variance cube over the integral length scale. That's the low order property, the second order properties of turbulence that has not been shown from a mathematical perspective. I'm not aware of any beginning of a demonstration of this, but that has been observed everywhere in the world. So what is happening, and which is not given by the kinetic energy budget, you will get it instead of looking at the budget of the kinetic energy. You will take a look at the budget of the kinetic energy, but of the filtered velocity at a given scale L. So it's a coarse graining procedure. Okay. So if you want to take a look at this, actually, you really think about it, it's equivalent to look for the budget, not of the amplitude square of velocity, but of the two-point function of velocity. So if you do that, so you can compute it from the Navier-Stokes. This is almost the same budget, but there is a new term here, which is very important, that will completely govern the energy transfer through scales. So in an average sense, that equation is called the Karman and Oors equation. Very recently, and Kolmogorov was very smart to focus on the stationary solution to reach one of the exact fourth, fifth law of turbulence that I will show after. And that has been recently revisited by many people in the context of the Onsager conjecture. So there is the work of Einck, Constantine, E. Maida, Duchamp-Robert, and in the framework of the weak solutions. All right. So if you do that, and you end up, so if you do that, but now that term is bounded. So when nu gets to zero, it will go to zero. At a finite length scale L, the viscosity term is bounded. So since it's proportional to nu, it will go to zero as nu goes to zero. It's bounded. And what remains only is that relationship that says that the, as we will see, the energy transfer term is equal in average to minus four times epsilon. So that's well-known results. Huh? It's my introduction. So that one to measure experimentally is a bit tough because it's the velocity vector. It has three components in three directions. It's very complicated. So you make use of the isotropic condition of the probability law, the invariance through the rotation group, and you take the average. So you have many similar terms. So if you do it properly, people did it, you end up with the famous fourth, fifth law of Kolmogorov that says that the average of the cube of the velocity, increment, doesn't go to zero as L cube, but much slower, it goes to zero proportional to L. So if you take a look at the experiments, this is what you are seeing. So here I'm representing the third order structure function, which is the third moment of the velocity increment obtained in wind tunnel at a small Reynolds number, bigger Reynolds number, bigger, bigger, bigger. And if the Reynolds number is big enough, you are reaching a plateau, which is completely given by that relation. So people in DNS, they've been doing crazy DNS, direct numerical simulation of the Navier-Stokes equation. And they are seeing it. And when you are performing a direct numerical simulation, it's really easy to get all the velocity components, to have a proper estimation of the average dissipation, etc. So they do things very properly. and they have a beautiful plateau here. So first conclusion, so that will be the single results that we can get from the Navier-Stokes equation after assuming a lot of hypotheses. I repeat myself, I assume that I'm reaching a statistically stationary state, which is not obvious. I'm assuming that the variance gets independent on the viscosity, which is far from being obvious. And in this situation, if you look at the Karman and Oors equation, you end up with that exact relationship. And that will be a final argument, theoretical argument from the Navier-Stokes equation. Second very important remark, that if this relation is true, velocity cannot be Gaussian. The probability law of velocity increment is not symmetrical. The third order moment is non-vanishing. It cannot be Gaussian. This is the first step towards intermittency. Very good. So intermittency. So here I'm, so I've been looking at the second order statistical quantities. Now I'm looking at third order quantities. So I want to see what is happening at fourth order quantities. And even I would like to see and observe how behaves the probability density function of velocity increment as a function of scales. This is the plot. So we can see so here I consider the velocity increment over a certain length scale L, and I represent the probability density function of velocity increment as a function of the velocity increment. So the histogram of the velocity increment extracted from the velocity profile that we measured in the wind tunnels. We can see that at large scale, the velocity increment is basically Gaussian. But when you go inside through the inertial range, you have that continuous shape deformation of the probability density functions. And that shows that the velocity field at small scales, meaning quantified by the velocity increment, are less and less Gaussian as the scales goes to zero. This is usually what people call the intermittency phenomenon. Okay, so I need to check the, yes, that's fine. So a way to...
Just to define it for me again, to understand, yes, what please. Is my intermittency.
Intermittency is a general, it's a general word, word. So I will be precising my words when I will be talking a little bit about what we call the multifractal formalism. But Jalal, at this stage, what people call intermittent effects, that's basically non-Gaussian effects. The velocity field in turbulence, hydrodynamic turbulence, I will be talking about wave turbulence after also.
No, okay, but for you now, is that just that it's non-Gaussian means it is intermittency? That's what I should understand.
And how is it non-Gaussian? So a way to precise my words and to precise the non-Gaussianity of the velocity field is to compute the flatness of the velocity increment, which is the fourth order moment divided by the square of the second order moment. And you can, so if the velocity field U was Gaussian, it should be 3. And it's 3 only at very large scales. Because here I'm plotting the logarithm of the flatness divided by 3 as a function of the scale. I will talk about the coefficients just after. And here, so only above the integral length scale, the velocity field can be considered as Gaussian. But when you enter the inertial range, you have a universal power law. It means independent on the large scale shape of the flow, if you are using oil or water or air, it will be the same. And you have in the inertial range a universal power, such as you have K minus 5/3 in the inertial range for the power spectrum, or L to the 2/3 in the inertial range for the second order structure functions. The flatness behaves as a power law in the inertial range with a universal number, which is whatever small, which is minus 0.1 here. So I'm renormalizing here scales by the Reynolds number and the flatness by the Reynolds number, because here I'm comparing a very low Reynolds number flow, obtained from a very small direct numerical simulation, and the one in Modane, which has a huge Reynolds number. So if I was not renormalizing things, I will have DNS just here. We won't be seeing anything, and Modane would be huge. So that's why I'm renormalizing things to see something. Okay. So that's basically what we would like to model and then understand. So there is another view of things which is important and which is more recent. So that's common knowledge in the community of turbulence, I think.
Excuse me, can I ask a question?
Yes, go ahead.
So in the graph of the on the left hand side, where you plot, you said the probability distributions of the velocity, you said, or of the velocity increments. Yeah.
Yes.
So those graphs that you are plotting are different probability distributions for different length scales?
Yes, thank you. So that's at large scales. Here I'm renormalizing all the PDF. They are all of unit variance. Okay, because we won't see anything if I was not doing so. So that's the large scales here, the integral length scales. And when you enter the inertial range, you have that. So L is a integral length scale divided by 4, by 16, by 32, etc. So here the flatness is growing, and that corresponds in for the PDF to that continuous shape deformation. Is it okay?
Yeah. So that the tails get bigger and bigger, right?
Yes, and that's okay. Consistent with the behavior of the flatness.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
So another way to see this is to go in the Lagrangian framework. Oh yes, so that's a huge literature. People, so here in the wind tunnel, you using what people call a hot wire, you just have access to a 1D slice of the velocity field, but the real field is 3D, spatial, it's very complicated. So people have invented very sophisticated experimental techniques to have to access to the full velocity field in the three directions, et cetera, et cetera. They were doing some crazy hot wires with 18 hot wires coupled to calibrate that thing. I think it was a mess. But anyway, they did it. They used a holographic particle image velocimetry. So the technology behind that thing to take a snapshot of the turbulent field, it's crazy. People were using optical technique with a very fast cameras to measure, because everything is fluctuating a lot, both in space and time, etc. So to catch up these fluctuations in the experiment, it's very difficult. And also the use of supercomputers is very convenient. And for small Reynolds number, it's very cheap. I can even do it on my laptop. And now people with very big computers, they are doing crazy direct numerical simulation at a huge Reynolds number. And that is very convenient because I'm very lazy. And DNS, you have access to anything you want. But the boundaries are very schematical, it's periodic boundaries, etc. So it's not the end of the story, but I have to confess it's very convenient. And so you can access to the full velocity gradient tensor, meaning you have the variation, the spatial variation of velocity along the three directions, which makes a matrix with all the velocity component and their variation in all the directions. And I could say many things about that, but I won't. Something which is important to know is the other framework of fluid mechanics, which is the Lagrangian one. So let's see what is happening. Instead of taking a picture of the flow and looking at the spatial variations of the fluid, stick on a fluid particle and follow the fluid along the trajectories of particles. So people did a lot of experiments. So it's not only these people that were doing that in DNS or in experiments, that's many people doing it anyway. So you take a closed fluid with a machine and you inject energy everywhere to make sure that this is more or less isotropic. So this machine is called von Karman flow. You inject in, so it's very convenient to have that in the physics department because it's very small. If you were putting the wind tunnel of Modane, which is 150 meters long in the physics department, there will be no place for me. So you do it in a closed flow and you put some particles, very small and with the same density of the water, and you follow them and you try to measure somehow. I won't be talking about it because I'm not sure that I know that I'm competent, but you are able to follow the velocity along the flow. You go with the flow. All right, and you plot, for instance, a velocity time profile, so that's an evolution in time, along the trajectories of the particles, and you plot the velocity as a function of time, and you have something like that. So here I'm giving the definition of the Lagrangian velocity, which is velocity is the Lagrangian velocity at time t is the Eulerian one at the position of the fluid particle. So by eyes, you can see that, let's go back to the spatial velocity profile of velocity. It's very rough. So we say, for those who know, it's in a certain average sense, it's older one third. That's Earth exponent one third, older exponent in average is one third. Very rough. It's rougher than the, I cannot pronounce that word, rougher. It's rougher than the Brownian motion. Whereas Lagrangian velocity, it's very smoother. And actually you can, from a dimensional point of view, you expect from in the Lagrangian framework to have a older continuity, not of older in average one third, but one half, like the Brownian motion. So you expect in average that the velocity along the trajectories is kind of similar to a Brownian motion. For the velocity, not for the position, for the velocity. So you do that, you have, so this is what I said. So instead of having k minus 5/3, you have something with frequency to the minus 2, which is consistent with what I said about the older continuity of order one half. And the second order structure function, so you have the dissipative range and the integral length scale here. And in between you have the inertial range, so the power law is not tau to the 2/3, but it's tau. A super toy that is given by Johns Hopkins University, and it's not COVID, it's Hopkins for turbulence. You can download anything, all the data. You can ask anything, the velocity, velocity gradient. You can download all the DNS fields in a huge resolution. And you can play around and you can plot this kind of stuff. It's please take a look at this website. It's awesome. And you can understand many things, etc. So, okay, second order statistical properties are that one. So I recall you expect all the, I will define during the lecture series, what is the older exponent? I have no time here. And so that's second order statistical properties. To higher order statistical properties, you have the same phenomenon, but much more violent. The intermittency phenomenon in the Lagrangian framework is much more violent in the Lagrangian framework. So here I represent, for instance, the histogram of the velocity increment at large scales. It's almost Gaussian. And when you enter in the dissipative, in the inertial range, you have a continuous shape deformation of the probability density function, but much more. And that could be understood. So I will try to talk about it, about the theory of Borgas, if I have time. The flatness also is growing much faster than the equivalent Eulerian one, but with the same phenomenology. But the power law is instead of having, so it's minus, yes, I forgot the minus. So instead of having minus 0.1, I have minus 0.34. So it's much more intermittent. Is it okay? Jalal, you stop me. Huh? I can talk for 8 hours. Huh? So.
Oh, no, but we still have time.
Okay.
I would not. We all have time. But this is great. Please go on.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So one of the wheel of our collaboration. No. So as I said, it's non-Gaussian. Okay. I think it's the observation is clear. And so how is it non-Gaussian? So I can cook up for you, if you want, many random fields and stochastic.
I have a question, in fact. Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Yeah, so this picture that you have here, of this new law, can you rephrase it in terms of regularity?
So yes, so it's in the language of the multifractal formalism, it's well included. And I'm sorry, I won't have time to talk about it. I will propose you a plan for the forthcoming lecture series. Okay. And I'm planning to include this kind of language and to give precise definitions of the local regularity of functions in the language of the multifractal formalism, but not today. It's okay?
Sure, thank you.
Okay. So there are many ways I can, so as I was explaining, I can cook up some crazy random fields and stochastic process for you that reproduce that thing. So, and it's not unique. So I need a further characterization and constraints to that, and that I enter in the world of multifractals. The thing is, for those who know, basic representations of the on the non-differentiability of these functions and the regular older continuous property is to use fractional Brownian motions. Okay, and that thing predicts that basically the amplitude of the fluctuations are short-range correlated over the Kolmogorov dissipative scales. I will come back to these points after. The thing that in turbulence, whereas, so here I'm considering, for instance, the small scales of the velocity field given by the gradients, so the derivative of the velocity with respect to x. But instead of just taking that, I take the square and I look at the correlation function of the dissipation. And what I see is that that quantity is long-range correlated. And that's another feature of the intermittency phenomenon. Intermittency comes in burst. You have an intermittent burst, and the largest size of this burst is the integral length scale of your turbulent fluid. So you have high fluctuations, but when you have a high fluctuation of the gradients, it comes in pack. You have a big pack of intermittent burst, and the biggest size of this burst is basically the large scale of the flow. That's very tricky to understand that thing. And you have the same thing for the Lagrangian velocity. Whereas acceleration is correlated over the small time scale, the correlation of the amplitude of acceleration is correlated over the integral time scale. Once again, it's a manifestation of the bursty nature of that, of these very violent events. And that's very important to build up a probabilistic theory of these turbulent functions. Okay, well, I will, so that's, will make part, I will try to explain these things in the forthcoming lectures. Very good. So another mission that Jalal gave me, so it's 4:30, is to talk, so what is happening in wave turbulence. So here I would like to illustrate that with a couple of experiments. So the first one, so there are many, I chose the one of my colleagues. Sorry, I hope they are here. So for instance, you take some mercury and you shake it. A parameter of the experiment, which is very important, is the amplitude of the forcing. There will be different behaviors if you force slightly or strongly. So if you shake the thing very slightly, everything will remain more or less Gaussian. So first, let me show you the behavior of the power spectrum of the eighth of the surface. And that was compared with the theory of Zakharov. I guess he was working with shallow water equations, trying to do the wave turbulence analysis of shallow water equations.
No, it's deep water, Laurent.
It's deep water. So we have a specialist, Nicolas Mort. Thank you, Nicolas. Okay, so I start, saying things in which I'm not very competent. Thank you, Nicolas. But the behavior of the power spectrum of the eighth is the one here. So you can see you have two power laws. One, which is very steep, minus 4.3, and the other one, which is not as steep, which is minus 2.8. So when you know the regularity of functions, it means that in the what I would call, excuse me, Nicolas, if I'm not precise, I will say that that part of the signal is even smoother. It's more than one time differentiable. The spectrum is so steep that if you have some irregularity on the signal, you have to take to look at them at higher order, at derivatives of higher order. So that's why Falcon and co-workers were computing not the eighth increment, but the second order eighth increment. So if you do it properly, and because the signal actually, you can take a look here on the series, on the time series, it's actually very smooth. So if you do that, once again, you recover that continuous shape deformation. So in this sense, simple systems given by, so it's not, so maybe Nicolas won't be happy, but so that's a system it's a wave turbulence system. And once again, you can observe in this system some intermittent effects. In the same kind of, in the same way as in a strong turbulence and the hydrodynamics.
Sorry, Laurent, I missed something. How is the slope related to the smoothness of the function? Did you say that?
So basically, for smooth function, you expect the power law spectrum to decrease faster than the power law of exponent minus 3. Okay. Or even faster exponential cutoff. But it has to be steeper than minus 3. Here you have minus 4.3. Okay. So that's very smooth.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
if you do the same analysis only with the increments and not the second order increments, everything will remain Gaussian. But if you do it properly, because the situation is very smooth, and you plot the probability density function, you observe once again that continuous shape deformation. So it's a similar, but not completely equivalent. Okay. Bon.
Okay.
Second illustration of the existence of intermittency in wave turbulence is the system of Nicolas Mordant. Instead of shaking mercury, he is shaking plates, metal plates. It's very loud. So I invite you to see some movies of Nicolas. He's shaking the plate. It's crazy loud. And he is able to measure the height of the plate for different forcing conditions. In parallel, they were doing a numerical simulation of a simple system, which is given by the Foppel-von Karman equations, which are given here. That looks like a wave equation plus some non-linearity given with a certain functional form that I won't be commented. But they were able to illustrate their experimental findings using additional numerical simulations. And here I represent, so on the top, that's the experiments for different forcing amplitude. And at the bottom is the equivalent spectrum obtained in numerical simulations for different forcing conditions. And I will let, in the future, please invite Nicolas Mordant to talk about this. And they were obtaining different power laws, etc. So there is also numerical work by Shibaro and Josserand on that problem. All right. So that's the spectrum. So if you look at higher order statistics on different quantities, you have a gain. So it's not, so Shibaro and Josserand, they were also looking at the second order increment of the eighth of the, the eighth of the plate. But Mordant was using instead the curvature L and G that I have no time to define. Okay. And they were observing once again that continuous shape of deformation from the Gaussian or non-Gaussian on the right, because it's a highly nonlinear quantity, so you don't expect things to be Gaussian. But you have the, once again, the continuous shape deformation of the probability of the underlying probability laws. Okay. Okay, so I'm done soon, and I was, I hope, clear enough such that I'm not able to talk about my own work, which is great. Oh, yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Very interesting also work of Miguel, of Sergio Shibaro, De Lillo, and Miguel Honorato. So we have seen experiments, we have seen numerical simulation of some dynamical equations. So let's focus on a certain model. So there is that nice model of Maida, McLaughlin, and Tabak. And these people, there were, so it's it originates from different interests. And these people, we're studying a particular case of that Maida, McLaughlin, Tabak model. And here I reproduce that on the right. So it looks like a nonlinear Schrodinger equation because the viscous term, the diffusion term, excuse me, is in D. And to that you add a nonlinearity cubic. And you have an additional term which is not in NLS, but whatever. and you have a forcing. So once again, I'm always looking at systems where you inject energy and with additional dissipation. So they were studying numerically this problem for different forcing. So that's at low forcing. So the red is at low, no, the blue is at low forcing, and the red is at higher amplitude forcing. And you can observe that changing the amplitude of the forcing is changing the slope of the average of the norm square of the solution of the wave function, psi. And actually, they were able to show that the slope of the power spectrum depends almost linearly with the amplitude of the forcing. So that's just the second order statistical quantity. And if you look at higher order statistics, once again, so you compute, so that's the histograms of the increments of psi. Yes, that's a psi. So if you look at the histograms of the increment of psi at the low forcing, you have almost everything Gaussian. But if you take a look at what is happening when you have a high amplitude forcing, and you look at the histograms of the increment of psi, you have once again that phenomenon of the continuous shape deformation of the probability density function. So in this sense, the Maida-McLaughlin-Tabak model is exhibiting some intermittent effects. And also, I invite the audience to take a look at these theoretical developments of Beaven, Nazarenko, and Newell. And they were interested in this kind of behaviors from the kinetic equations, et cetera, that I have no time to develop here. And I would like to conclude, though, with the plan that I'm proposing you to follow for the bravest. They will come in February. So in the first lecture, I would like to take some time to define properly what is how you quantify the regularity of non-differentiable functions. And maybe in a couple of lines to define what is the older continuity. So doing that, I will consider the dimension of the support of the older exponents, and that I will call the spectrum singularities, which is at the core of what people say called the multifractal formalism. I have the quote by Roberto Benzi that I like a lot, which says that multifractal formalism is not a model, it's a language, which I completely agree. And to illustrate that on a basic probability object, I would like to show you, after the work of Jaffar, to show you that almost all the time, if there is not only a Brownian component, Levy processes in this sense are multifractal. Second lecture is to talk about models. So the famous one, simple model of intermittency, is what people call the shell models. That I would like to spend some time to define and review a little bit the results that we can get again from it. To go back a little bit, if I have something more to say, that I'm not sure, but about the model of Maida-McLaughlin-Tabak that I just presented. And also gaining something that comes from the Russian school of the theory of turbulence, Yaglom, etc., to present you what is a discrete random cascade models, which is a way to build up a random field that reproduces a lot of these intermittent effects. Last lecture would be to first start with what is non-intermittent. So for me, what is not intermittent is a fractional Brownian motion, or more generally speaking, a fractional Gaussian field, which has the same power spectrum that we have seen in the experiment, but which is Gaussian. So the flatness is always three. There is no intermittency in it. And I will show you a way. That's a probabilistic model that is called a multiplicative chaos, which is basically a continuous version of the discrete random cascade models that I mentioned in the that I will mention in the second lecture, that will produce intermittent effects and that long-range correlated nature of the fluctuations. Okay, so I think I'm done. I talk enough. And please follow the forthcoming lectures. I will try to do something clear. And that's it. I'm done. Thank you.
Thanks, Laurent. Great lecture. Great. Very clear. Thank you. We have time for very quick questions. We have a couple few minutes if you anyone has. In that case, the lectures will be announced later on. And they will be given on Mondays and Wednesdays at 10 a.m. So with that in mind, I hope to see you there. And thanks again for a great talk.
Laurent, can I ask a question maybe?
Yes, Erwan. Excuse me, Erwan. If after the talk of Erwan and my talk, you are not bored of French accent, it's already a success.
No, just to advertise for your second lecture, what do you mean by shell models?
Ah, so come to my second lecture.
Okay, no, but is it an elasticity model? Or?
No, not no, at no. all.
Okay. It's not related to plates of Nicolas Mordant.
No.
Okay.
Great. Okay.
But, I'll be there anyway.
I have a question. Laurent?
Yes.
Hi.